One of the most requested movies for Film Analysis Breakdown that I've received over the years is The Dark Knight. I've had requests for this from fans of the film and from those who think it's overrated. It's rare that I make videos about movies that I don't particularly like, but for some reason, recently I felt the urge to go back and give Dark Knight another watch. And in doing so, I took 32 pages of detailed notes. In some ways, I grew to like the film a little bit more in this recent viewing, but I also clarified my reasons for thinking the film is overrated. In this video, I'll be giving the positives, the things I do like about the film, or at least what I find is interesting, and later on I'll post a second video outlining what I really don't like. Oh, and one other thing before we get started, I've deliberately not read or watched any other studies of Dark Knight, so I don't know, there may be some overlap with other reviews that are out there. Let's start with the obviously good points of the film, the Joker character, who is played very effectively by Heath Ledger. Most of the film's best qualities are related to this character as far as I can tell, and he has nearly all of the best dialogue lines. The messy makeup, scars and scraggly hair give him a more menacing edge than previous incarnations of the Joker character, and this fits with the philosophy that he espouses. His idea that the efforts of others to control the world are pointless, be they politicians or criminals, and that his aim is to show everybody that there is no control. Joker's messy physical appearance matches with this worldview. In fact, his chaotic appearance reminds me of Scorpio, the psychopathic killer in Dirty Harry. Like with the Scorpio character, Joker finds a lot of humour in committing his crimes, like he's announcing a cosmic joke that there is no morality, and the world always was and always will be a realm of lawless chaos. His emotional indifference to physical pain is an important trait for several reasons. It fits with his acceptance that life is chaotic, like he's come to accept pain as an inevitable part of existence. He may have even learned to enjoy it, just as he takes meditative enjoyment of the chaotic breeze and swaying of a car racing down the street after he's just blown up a police station, or of being hung upside down off of a building 100-odd floors up. But also, villains who are indifferent to their own physical pain, such as Joker's mouth wounds, which he said he inflicted on himself, those kinds of masochistic characters are powerful in fiction because a person who can severely self-harm is not likely to feel empathy for the pain of other people. Some extreme horror examples of this are Freddy Krueger in the Nightmare on Elm Street films and the Cenobites in Hellraiser. We know that these characters are going to do nasty things to us because they do nasty things to themselves. And in real life, serial killers often have a history of self-harm. So when Joker holds a blade to a woman's face and explains how he scarred himself, it lends credibility to the idea that he might do the same to her. Joker's destructive urges toward the world could even be an expression of his desire to self-destruct. Here, he walks head-on toward incoming Batman on a bike, saying he wants Batman to run him down. So he's kind of like the psycho in the movie The Hitcher, or the many spree killers who gun down dozens of people knowing that they'll be killing themselves later in the act. His entire crime spree basically being one giant act of suicide. Joker has some interesting and inventive plans in how he carries out his crimes, hiring men to do bank jobs, but privately assigning them to kill each other during completion of the job. They wipe each other out and he takes the loot. But also inserting himself into the team without their knowledge, presenting himself as a supposed dead corpse in another scene as a means of getting to a mob boss who wants him dead. These little scheming inventive plans are good, and it's an aspect of psychopathy that I find very interesting. Psychopaths tend to allow their thoughts and their fantasies to wander into dangerous territory, and this can give them an intellectual edge that the rest of us tend to lack, because we suppress our more violent and manipulative thoughts, which instead resurface in our dreams and nightmares or are expressed indirectly through other behaviours without us realising it. In other words, we don't allow ourselves to consciously consider the kinds of behavioural options that psychopaths do. Joker sums this up in his argument that behavioural rules limit the ability of police and Batman in stopping his crimes. So it's like a game of chess in which he can make a much wider variety of moves because he doesn't follow the rules of the game. I think this is something that often makes psychopaths seem more intelligent than average people. They simply have more options. Joker's acceptance and embracing of his outcast status fits very well. He considers other people to be in denial of the natural and inevitable chaos of life and that their behavioural rules are like blindfolds. So in his view, people inevitably are unable to understand him. When one character claims, some men just want to watch the world burn, it's not quite true. Highly destructive people still have very specific underlying reasons why they want to watch the world burn. They might deserve the death penalty for what they do, but they still have their reasons for their crimes. Another area of the film that I'm interested in is perception of the hero. Michael Caine, or whatever the hell his character's name in the film is, I can't remember, he says that Batman needs to be more than a hero, that he must be willing to be seen as the bad guy in order to do the right thing. And yes, this is often true in life, and it's amazing how most people, even intelligent ones who claim to be of high moral fibre, they become silent when there isn't a protective crowd to follow, and especially if speaking up means going against a crowd alone. Very few people have the guts for that. However, there's a whopping irony in all this. Joker also perceives being seen as the bad guy as necessary to his cause. And his repeated assertion that he and Batman are alike shows that he thinks Batman is at heart a deluded criminal who thinks he's a hero. I like this paradox. Movies about good and evil are much more interesting when the hero has a villain streak and the villain has a hero streak. And Joker is onto the fact that most people simply play the role of being a good person because it's fashionably convenient to do so.
I'll show you. When the chips are down, these civilized people, they'll eat each other.
You know what I noticed? Nobody panics when things go according to plan. Even if the plan is horrifying.
Ain't that the truth? With all this stuff in mind, it got me wondering if Joker is intended to be a kind of ghost in this movie, an invincible manifestation of Batman's ugly side. The white face paint makes him look like a ghost. He has no name, no DNA records, no fingerprints. It's like he just materialised out of thin air. Perhaps there's a plot point I missed, but I never understood why Batman swerves Joker here and avoids killing him. Maybe he can't kill him. As Joker says,
"You complete me."
Or to put it the other way, Joker completes Batman. It's kind of like the chaotic character Tyler in the movie Fight Club, who was an expression of the darker traits of the lead character. Or stronger traits, depending on your point of view. I very much like that Joker is disinterested in money and destroys the money of people who think they have great power. The burning pyramid of dollar bills is as anti-capitalist a statement as anyone could ever make. We're all caught up in a financial pyramid scheme run by banks who could easily reprint all this money anyway. As we recently found out with the COVID-19 disaster, suddenly the banks have got the money to pay everyone's wage for a couple of months while they sit at home. And the aspirations of men to become more and more rich, even when they're already set up for life, for them, money becomes symbolic of a conquest for ever-expanding ego. A Joker is against all of this. And this is the big contradiction that I like. The money-burning gesture, which appeals to our anti-capitalist, anti-materialist side, is made by a villain who expresses a different meaning.
It's not about money. It's about sending a message. Everything burns.
You know that old saying that sometimes good people do bad things? Well, it's also true that sometimes bad people do good things. It's a whopping great myth in our society that the people with the best plans and who actually do the most good are, by default, the nicest and most virtuous people. That's not true at all. A lot of people sincerely, from the bottom of their heart, mean well, but they hardly ever take an effective action that actually helps a large number of people. Sure, they might be more likely to give money to a homeless person on the street from time to time, but they won't do something that has a big positive effect for a lot of people. So it could be argued that Joker, by burning the money of the city's biggest gangs and thus lessening their power, is a more effective hero than either Harvey Dent, the crime-fighting lawyer, or Batman himself, the billionaire gimp who runs about in a batsuit. How much of a hero would Bruce Wayne be if his billions were burned as well?
Upset the established order, and everything becomes chaos.
Man, the things this guy could achieve if he applied himself in a more humane direction. Let's take a look at the character Two-Face. He's the crime-fighting lawyer who is very much a good guy in the story until he gets half his face burned and becomes a villain, driven by the desire for revenge. His coin-tossing philosophy is interesting, though it was already done in the movie No Country for Old Men the year before Dark Knight was released. Very different styles of movie, but there is some thematic overlap in terms of how good and bad guys perceive themselves and each other. Oh, funnily enough, there was an invincible ghost-like element to the villain in No Country for Old Men, just like with the Joker and Two-Face in this movie. Harvey Dent, before he became Two-Face, was presented as the Batman of the courtrooms, and he even lies to the news media that he is Batman so as to protect the real Batman's identity. But then Joker arranges for Dent's girlfriend to die and for Dent to blame others for the injustice and seek revenge on them. So I think of Two-Face as being Batman and Joker mixed into a single character. The burnt face makeup is pretty gruesome. I don't think the left eye would be functional after the lid was literally burned off, and there would be serious infections in that eye. But that's not the point. It looks menacing, and it's symbolic of his evil side coming to the surface. I mean, we're all two-faced, aren't we? We all have an evil side, an angry, vengeful side that blames the world for our suffering and wants to see the world burn as a result of it. And we all wear masks of goodness in certain situations, just as the Joker passes himself off as a nurse. Two-Face's coin flips for justice, I think, are a variation on Joker having embraced the chaos of life. This is interesting to me because we humans look at the animal kingdom, which is full of cruelty and injustice that's built into the evolutionary and ecological systems, and we not only accept all of nature's colossal suffering, which dwarfs the cruelty caused by man, but we even worship nature as a divine, beautiful thing, like it's all just God's will. So isn't Two-Face's acceptance of the natural order through the randomness of a coin toss, isn't that the same as our acceptance of nature's two-faced beauty and ugliness? Although there is the contradiction that he personally chooses what outcomes to pin on each side of the coin before he flips it, with one of those choices being the violent revenge outcome that he wants. Here, the coin gives the outcome he doesn't want, so he throws a punch instead.
Sorry. Live to fight another day, officer.
But he didn't flip the coin to see if she should be punched. So, in effect, he is the two faces of the coin, passing his own decisions off as natural law. And that was the same paradigm that existed for the character Chigurh in the movie No Country for Old Men. Final issue for part one of this video, The War on Terror, which was still in full swing back in 2008 when Dark Knight was released, but public backlash against the War on Terror was building up massively at the time. Mass surveillance was a big concern in the War on Terror, and it was all triggered by the 9/11 attacks. So the Dark Knight movie delves a bit into the ethics of surveillance technology, but in a rather crude and obvious way. However, it's something that kids and teenagers who saw the movie would likely understand, so maybe that's a good thing. At the same time, the temporary use of mass surveillance by Batman to catch Joker arguably plays into a pro-War on Terror position. Centralised mass surveillance is cited as wrong but necessary to stop terrorism, symbolised by the Joker. And the poster of the movie bizarrely shows a Batman logo burning on the side of a building in about the same size that a plane impact would be. I don't think there's any way that the designing of this poster was done without an awareness of the 9/11 attack reference. But surely in this story, if a character is to be equated with terrorism, it should be Joker, not Batman. And Joker is the one seen destroying a building in the movie, not by plane attack, but by rigged explosives. So, is there some sort of 9/11 truth message mixed into this movie? After all, 9/11 planned attack theories were very popular when the film was released, and the supposed use of rigged explosive in the buildings was part of that theory. So, these War on Terror related elements in The Dark Knight are a bit of a muddled message, but it gives the viewer more to think about. Alright, so that's pretty much all of the stuff that I either like or find interesting in The Dark Knight. So, Dark Knight is a great movie, right? Well, yes, in terms of the Joker character, I think it is, and to a lesser extent the Two-Face character, but there's also the other side of the coin, the more cliched and pretentious aspects of the film, which we'll be getting into in part two of this video. If you're not subscribed to my channel, then make sure you do, otherwise you might miss out on part two when I upload it. You've been listening to Rob Ager, thanks for watching. There's more film analysis videos here on my YouTube channels and on my website collativelearning.com. Bye for now, folks.